lawyer, it's award season, and I didn't realize this, but there are awards for the best lawyer of the year. And in Charlotte, North Carolina, the winner was a lawyer who had purchased a box of very rare and expensive cigars, and then he insured them against, among other things, fire. Within a month, having smoked his entire stockpile of these great cigars, and without yet having even made his first premium payment on the policy, the lawyer filed a claim against the insurance company. In his claim, the lawyer stated that the cigars were lost in a series of small fires. The insurance company refused to pay, citing the obvious reason, that the man had consumed the cigars in a normal fashion. And the lawyer sued the insurance company, and he won. Delivering on the ruling, the judge agreed that the insurance company's claim, with the insurance company, that the claim was frivolous. The judge stated, nevertheless, that the lawyer held a policy from the company which warranted that the cigars were insurable and guaranteed that they would be insured against fire without defining what is considered to be an unacceptable fire. Thus, they are obligated to pay the claim. Rather than endure the lengthy, costly appeal process, the insurance company accepted the ruling, paid $15,000 to the lawyer for his loss of cigars in the fires. Here's the best part. After the lawyer cashed his check, the insurance company had him arrested on 24 counts of arson. With his own claim and testimony from the previous case being issued against him, the lawyer was convicted of intentionally burning his insured property and was thus sentenced to 24 months in jail and a $24,000 fine. This is the first place winner of the Criminal Lawyers Award contest. I know it's not a true story. I did look at Snoop's before I read it, okay? But I used it because life can be a series of small fires. And eventually, they catch up with us. And we find ourselves burning the candle, as it were, at both ends, drained emotionally, drained sometimes spiritually, drained sometimes physically, and entering into what the ancients called the dark night of the soul, what we call depression. And I want to talk to you today, those of you who've been there, those of you who perhaps are there, or maybe you know someone, maybe someone lives in your home who's in the dark night of the soul, and I want to remind you, you're in very good company. Some of the greatest saints in all of history, most of the great saints in history, have suffered some form of depression. And the text we're looking at today is one of their favorite texts that God has used time and again to just give them a little coaching through that dark night of the soul. We're looking at 1 Kings 18. Look with me at verse 41. And Elijah said to Ahab, "Go up, eat, and drink, for there is a sound of a rushing rain." Remember, it hadn't rained for 3.5 years. Remember, Elijah had just called fire down from heaven, proving that his God was alive and the true God of Israel. Now it's preparing for God to lift the curse, to bring rain back on the land. It says, so Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to Mount Carmel and bowed himself down to the earth and placed his face between his knees. And he said to his servant, "Go up now and look toward the sea." And he went up and he looked at the sea and said, "There is nothing." He said, "Go again 7 times. And the 7th time he said, "Behold, there is a little cloud like a man's hand rising up to the sea, from the sea." So imagine, I was standing there last week. Those of you who traveled to Israel with us this time, you stood on Mount Carmel this week. And when we went over to the backside of the building, we could look from Mount Carmel and we could see the Mediterranean just off in the distance. And so here, he's looking out toward the sea, and he says, you know, if you held up your hand against the horizon, there's a cloud about that big coming. Elijah knew when that little evidence was given, he knew God was answering his prayer. And he said, go up and say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down, lest the rain stop you. And in a little while, the heavens grew black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain. And Ahab rode and went to Jezreel, and the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he gathered up his garment, and he ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. Now think of what had just happened in the life of this great prophet. This is the premier prophet of the Old Testament. When Jesus in the New Testament is on the Mount of Transfiguration, he meets with the two most significant figures in the Old Testament, Moses and Elijah. So they're there gathered with him on the Mount of Transfiguration. Not Isaiah, not Daniel, not Ezekiel, Elijah. Elijah, this great man who stood against the opposing gods, the idols of Israel, and he called fire down from heaven. He had just executed, in obedience to Deuteronomy, he executed the false prophets. And now he prayed, and the New Testament tells us Elijah was just an ordinary guy like us. And he prayed, and God sent rain on the land. Not Elijah's power, but he called upon the God who brings rain. And so here, a deluge has just come upon the land. And you imagine, if you're Elijah, and you've just done this wonderful thing, you've saved your country, how do you expect to be rewarded? I imagine something like the closing scene of some of the Star Wars movie, where the heroes are gathered there on the steps of the palace, and the king or the queen puts a medallion on them. Or maybe a edict that says a statue will be erected in honor of Elijah to stand as a perpetual memorial of his greatness and how he saved our nation. Neither of those happened. As a matter of fact, the very opposite. Jezebel, the wife of Ahab, the queen in Israel, puts a bounty on the head, and she goes on to say, may the gods deal with me ever so severely if I do not make Elijah like one of the prophets of Baal, meaning dead, by this time tomorrow. Things didn't go the way he had expected. He had just had the greatest experience of his life. Imagine the emotional state he had been in. Imagine that mountaintop experience. But rather than being encouraged and built up, his life was threatened. We see in chapter 19, verse 3, then he was afraid. Previously, he had stared down. He had taunted. He had stood boldly against 450 men. But now, he's terrified of this woman. What happened? Well, his tanks were drained. Emotionally, physically, and spiritually, the prophet of God is absolutely empty. And it says, he arose and he ran for his life, and he came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and he left his servant there. According to the commentators that I've read on this passage, that was his resignation from ministry. He had just led the greatest revival in the history of the nation, but now he feels and fears there's no more that he could do to accomplish for good. He's done. He's not going to teach Sunday school this year. He's not keeping the nursery anymore. He's not going to teach. He's not going to preach. He's done. He leaves his servant behind saying, I have no further need of a staff because I don't have any need to do ministry anymore. Verse 4. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. And he came and he sat down under a broom tree, and he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I'm no better than my father's. And it's then that Elijah slips into what we call the dark night of the soul. He knew enough about God, he knew enough about God's word to know better than to take his own life. Folks, listen, if you ever are tempted, and some of you will be, tempted to take your own life, please remember, may these words haunt you, and may they come powerfully into your life when you're in that moment of temptation. It's not yours to take. You have been bought with a price. You are not your own. Elijah, knowing he couldn't take his own life, he asked the God who owned him to take his life. Have you ever been that low? You ever felt like that? If so, it's nothing to be embarrassed about. You're in very, very good company. I read this week, many years ago, a young Midwestern lawyer suffered from such a deep depression that his friends thought it was best to keep all knives and razors and weapons out of his reach. He had questioned his life's calling and the prudence of even attempting to follow through on his career. During this time, he wrote, "I am the most miserable man alive. Whether I shall ever get any better, I cannot tell. I awfully forebode that I shall not." But somehow, somewhere, Abraham Lincoln received the encouragement he needed to continue on and achieve his life's great purpose. You're in good company. Practically every king of Israel went through a depression. The first king, Saul, was only relieved when David played his harp. David also suffered in the pit of depression. Solomon was the poster child for depression. He wrote Ecclesiastes. If you're not depressed, read Ecclesiastes and you will be, all right? I mean, that's just the nature of life. It's not that it's spiritual to be depressed, but spirituality certainly doesn't deliver you from it. Paul, at one point, said, "I despaired even of life." Jonah had just preached the greatest crusade of all times in Nineveh and then sat down and asked God to just let him die. You're in good company. Elijah is there in our text. Why? Well, there's a lot of reasons, and I'm not going to insult the situation by trying to reduce it down to a simple answer, because a lot of times when you're in depression, there's not a simple answer. But to put it in a way that we can wrap our mind around it, there seems to be a baseline, just let that be kind of a zero-sum line in life emotionally. And life is made up of times where you are exuberant and thrilled and joyful above that line, and then there seems to be an equal opposite trough or valley to where you're down. Jesus was anointed with the oil of joy, and he was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Not because of sin in his life, not because of any sinister reason. It was just the human experience. And Jesus fully lived the human experience, and so will you. It's unnatural to be perpetually above the line, and it's unnatural to be perpetually below the line. Generally, maturity lends itself to having a biblical worldview that keeps the exuberant highs in check and keeps the deep despair in check as well. As good as things may be, how many of you have noticed that we're kind of getting into tax season? Maybe you've got some refunds coming. How many of you have lived long enough to know? I'm 43. I'll be 44 next month. I've lived long enough to know that when you see an unexpected few thousand dollars come in, that almost inevitably you can just ask the question, well, what's going to break next? It's just going to happen. It's just normal. I used to get so excited, and then, well, guess what? Your car just broke, and it turns out you need the exact same amount as your tax refund. And how many of you have lived long enough to know that no matter how bad it gets, a Christian always has something to smile about? Folks, listen, the worst year of my life, and I don't talk a lot about it. I'm not going to talk a lot about it, but I do want you to know, just so that you understand, that I understand. 2012 was the worst year I've ever been through in my life. It was, but I knew at my darkest moment that was as close to hell as perhaps I'll ever get. Folks, there's people walking right now that everything seems to be going perfect in their life, and then you have to remember that may be as close to heaven as they ever get. But for us, things will always get better eventually. And a biblical education, a biblical worldview, kind of puts a governor on the ridiculous highs or ridiculous lows and helps you to kind of have a more stable emotional experience in life, to where there's not huge highs or huge valleys, but it's kind of more predictable. You know what's coming. And you'll have times to where you're, ridiculously happy. You'll have times where you're unusually down. It doesn't mean that much beyond your human. And what do you do? Well, there's a tendency for us to be reductionistic and to kind of make a simple answer to a very complex problem. And I want to show you that Scripture doesn't do that. And we shouldn't do that. Scripture takes a holistic approach, realizing that a person is body, soul, and spirit. Body, the physical part of you. Soul, mind, will, and emotions, the emotional part of you. And then spirit, the eternal part of you. When Jesus redeems you, He doesn't just redeem you spiritually, but He begins the process of making you new in soul and body as well. So when you go through a difficult valley, you have to remember that. And you have to remember not just for you, but your family's going to go through it. Your spouse is going to go through it. Your children may go through it. People in your small group may go through it. Learn how to read those signs. For what we think of as depression, when you see a female go through depression, it has the more typical signs of sadness and withdrawal. For a man, when they go through depression, sometimes it looks radically different than when a woman does. Sometimes it manifests in anger and frustration. Learn that. Learn how to watch the people you love and to minister to them in a holistic way. There's three general ways that we tend to reduce it down to a simple answer to a complex problem. One is basically a chemical problem. It's just chemistry. It reduces the person down to a basic chemistry experiment. So if they're low, you begin to suggest where they might find chemicals that will get them back up high again. Now, I'm not anti-medicine. I'm thankful we live in the day that we live. Sometimes I just sit there and say, thank God for antibiotics. Can you imagine? As romantic as the Middle Ages might be, they didn't have penicillin. And we live in a day where, thankfully, science has progressed and a lot of the problems of life we can address. But to reduce things down to it's always just a chemical issue is foolish at best and dangerous at worst. It can be chemical issues in your life. As a matter of fact, you'll find that when people go through certain things, they go through traumatic surgeries, heart surgery oftentimes will mess with a person's system, and they can have some chemical imbalances that medication can help. Birth, you've heard of the postpartum depression. It can cause certain things like that. So sometimes it can be a chemical issue. So I'm not saying that that's never an issue, but I'm saying to reduce it down to always being that, and always when you struggle, looking for appeal is a dangerous approach to life, and it's reductionistic. The opposite is true. And that is to take a moralistic approach and say, well, it's always a sin issue. And if you go through depression asking yourself, well, what have I done wrong that's landed me here? That's just as dangerous and just as foolish. It's not always a chemical problem. It's not always a spiritual problem. It can be a spiritual problem. At times, our sin does cause, David said, if it sinned that while I was unrepentant, my bones wasted away inside of me. It can be a spiritual problem, but if you always look at it as a spiritual problem, sometimes you'll just be going in circles. It's not always chemical. It's not always spiritual or moral. It's not always psychological. Sometimes when you go through this, your friends, meaning well, can recommend their counselor and say, well, you just need to talk it through. You just need to kind of unearth your childhood and figure out what happened that caused you to be in this situation now. It can be a psychological problem. And there is safety in a multitude of counselors. But Scripture doesn't ever reduce it down to a simple, one-shot approach. But it sees that God has created you as body, soul, and spirit, as a whole person, and it approaches emotional struggles holistically. And I would advise you to as well. How? How does God do that? Well, notice how God ministers to Elijah in verse 5. Elijah lay down and he slept under a broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and he drank and he lay down again. Elijah's just asked God to kill him. He drifts off. He wakes up. There's an angel there. I mean, he could be thinking, well, that was quick. God's answering my prayer. This angel's going to smote me and take me out. You know, smite me, whatever you call it. He's going to take me out. What would you think the angel was going to do? An angel. An angel. Have you ever seen an angel? I've never seen one. I don't know what it would be like. But suddenly there's a being there that's something different than human that you didn't expect to see. He's standing there, messenger from God. What's this angel going to say? I mean, is he going to rebuke Elijah and say, "How dare you? After all God has done for you, how dare you ask God to take your life? How dare you be down and depressed?" Well, the angel doesn't do that at all. The angel sizes up where Elijah's at and says, "Friend, you need something to eat." And he bakes food for him. You say, "Well, what did he bake?" Angel food cake, obviously. Can you imagine how that must have tasted? I mean, just parenthetically, that had to be an awesome. I mean, that was like better than Krispy Kreme donuts. Don't you just, and no calories. Don't you know that angel knew how to make like carb-free donuts? It would be amazing. But he makes Elijah cake in a jar of water, and he ministers to him physically. And he lets Elijah take a nap. Have you ever thought sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is take a nap? Eat a good meal. When you're going through this, and I'm going to talk more about this in a moment, but you have to know yourself. If I asked you right now, from 0 to 10, where are you emotionally? Where are you physically? Where are you spiritually? If you say, "Pastor, I'm about a 2 emotionally right now. I don't feel anything." That's okay. We go through that. Do you know how to get yourself to a 6 or a 7? Do you know how to refill your tank? Do you know, for some, it might be a good book. It might be going for a long walk. It might be listening to a good song. But do you know how to refill your tank? The angel takes Elijah and he says, "You need a good meal that you don't cook. And you don't have to clean up after. You need some rest." Have you ever looked at your wife and just said, you need some time off? I'm going to do the cooking, or we're going to eat out, but you need to rest. Have you ever looked at your children and just recognized that you can't coach them out of this emotional state? They're going to have to get some rest. The angel looks at Elijah and says, "I can fix this, but I'm going to feed you, and you're going to get some rest." And the Bible says in verse 8, he arose and he ate and he drank. Humans are not equations, they're multidimensional beings. This angel knew that, and he responded accordingly. Last part of verse 8. And Elijah went in the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. Now, I've read that probably 20 years now. I've read this story. And this passed right over my head. The Mount of God, Mount Horeb. When you think of Mount Horeb, does anything stand out to you? Is that a popular mountain in the Old Testament or the New Testament? Is it significant for any reason? I'll be honest with you, I didn't recognize it. Mount Horeb. What was in Mount Horeb? But then I realized that, as the Old Testament often does, they use different names for the same place. Mount Horeb is Mount Sinai. What happened on Mount Sinai? God met with Moses. God gave the law. God gave the scriptures to Moses on Mount Sinai. Elijah has physical issues. He needs rest. He needs food. He needs nourishment. But he also needs to get in the Word. He also needs to meet with God and spend some time with God. He needs to not only fill up his physical tank and his emotional tank, he needs to fill up his spiritual tank. And while so many of us can be tempted when we go through a difficult emotional experience to run from God, Elijah shows us that's the time to run to God. It's not just a spiritual fix, but it's not less than a spiritual fix either. Holistic ministering to this man of God. Now, I want to challenge you with three things. One, be responsible for yourself. You are your main advocate when it comes to your well-being and your health. Learn how to manage and measure your state of being. Ask yourself from time to time, at least once a week, how am I doing? How do I feel? Do I find myself becoming burnt out when it comes to ministry or when it comes to work or when it comes to family? Is there not enough fuel at the end of the day for you to be who you need to be as a grandma, as a dad, as an athlete, as a student, whatever it is? Is there just not enough fuel? And how can you learn your ways of filling that tank? You be your own advocate and take personal responsibility for your life. Realize that ups and downs are a part of life. Jesus, again, was anointed with oil of joy, and he was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Don't be too shocked by them. Build your worldview so that you can understand that every high and every low should be kept in its proper check. Secondly, learn how to advocate for those around you and be sensitive to things that you see in their lives when maybe they need a break, maybe they need some space, maybe they need you to minister to them rather than them minister to you for a change. But walk, the Bible speaks to husbands and says, walk, live with your wives in an understanding way. There's a lot to that, but I do believe it means you've got to learn the particular signals that your spouse gives when they're going through a rough time. And again, for some it might be tears, for others it may be anger, but learn to read them and say, you know what, she's at the end of her rope. She needs a little bit of space, she needs some time, she needs to rest, she needs a good walk on the beach, whatever it may be. Learn to read that person and minister to them accordingly, and you be that angel in their life. Then third, what has this got to do with Vision Sunday? We as a church, I believe, have a unique calling and responsibility. Scripture tells us where there's no vision, the people perish. It's vital that a church has a vision, a God-given vision. There's some aspects of vision that should be true of every ministry, every church, everywhere on earth. We're commanded to preach the word in season and out of season. So the preaching of the scriptures, the proclamation of the gospel, the discipleship of the saints, keeping of the ordinances. There are certain things that ought to be true of any church at any time over the last 2,000 years, anywhere on the planet. We're not to get creative and say, well, maybe there's a better way than preaching the Bible. No, there's not a better way. You're accountable to God. That's what you're supposed to do. So there are certain things that are uniform. God gives us that vision. Then there are certain things that are particular that you've got to ask, just as you would personally. I've got to ask for my own personal life, okay, God has made me uniquely with certain gifts, talents, and abilities. He's given me a certain family. He's put me in a certain place. Taking all of those things into account, how then should I live? Well, we know there's certain truth that applies to every Christian. You know, you don't bear false witness. You don't commit adultery. You know, there's certain truth. You love the Lord with all your heart. There's certain truth that applies to all of us the same. But then particularly, there's some things I can't do that I wish I could. There's some things I can do that other people can't. Based on that, how then should I live? As a church, we ought to ask the same question. We're uniquely placed as a church. We're on Amelia Island. People pay a lot of money just to visit here, much less live here. People work their whole life Some of you have worked your whole life, worked hard, saved up money so that one day you could retire right here. And God has blessed you with that ability, and you're here. Some of you today are on vacation. You're not from here, but you come here to be refreshed. This church, over 100 years old, God has planted it on this island. What difference does that make, Pastor? Here's what I believe it means. I believe that what that angel was to Elijah, this church can be to the kingdom. I stood last week, we went to visit the Dead Sea. We stayed one night in the Dead Sea. It's named appropriately. It is dead. I mean, it is in the middle of a desert wilderness. Nothing will grow. There's not a fish in that water. I'm telling you, bugs can't live in there. It's just so saline, so filled with minerals that nothing can survive. Not grass doesn't grow. It's just a desert wilderness. But then, as we were traveling north, heading toward Jerusalem, I asked our tour guide, I said, would it be possible for us to spend a little bit of time in En Gedi? En Gedi is there on the side of the highway. It almost seems like a mirage. You're in the middle of the desert. Everything is dead. But then suddenly, you approach this green oasis. Palm trees. Date palms, every kind of tree and flower you can imagine, little deer, goats, all kinds of animals scurrying around. You see this creek that flows into the Dead Sea. You follow the creek up and it's waterfall after waterfall. That water's not dead. That water is flourishing. It's alive. It's as clear as the rain itself. It's a natural spring of cold, clear living water in the middle of a desert oasis. It was En Gedi that David fled from King Saul when Saul was trying to take his life, and David and his mighty men hid in the caves of En Gedi. It's an oasis in the middle of the wilderness. Julie and I went there in 2009, and God put it on our heart then that should be a metaphor for our home, that our home should be an oasis in the middle of a dry land. We know we're going to go out and try to live a Christian life, and we're not going to find that that's really cool. It's not really acceptable. It's not really the thing to do. We know we're going to try to raise our kids in the fear and admonition of the Lord, and we're going to send them to school that very often will try to dismantle everything they've been taught. We knew that would happen. We also knew that they would need an oasis in the middle of the wilderness. So we decided early on to create a home that they could come to, be nourished, be rested, be encouraged, and sent back out into the world. And so since 2009, that's been a metaphor for what we try to create in our home. I believe that is an appropriate metaphor for our church. That as we live in a post-Christian culture, that more and more is going to hear the Word of God and reject it. We're not in the category of the Christians under Nero in persecution. But it will be progressively, more and more people will find that they are overlooked when it comes for promotions because of their faith in Christ and their adherence to Scripture. You will see over the next decade people losing jobs, people being divorced because an unbeliever doesn't want to be married to a person who's given their life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And you are going to see more and more families struggling. You're going to see this year, and not just this year, but in the previous 5, 6 to 10,000 churches lock the door, turn off the lights, never to gather again. 6 to 10,000, just in our country, alone. Things are changing. We have seen some very encouraging signs. Our president came out recently and spoke in favor and made some changes to accommodate more freedom of religion in our schools. Thank God for that. There have been some good signs of progress. But folks, it's going to take a massive, massive course change in order to change the course on the direction that our culture is heading. We're going to need an oasis. You're going to have people in North Florida and South Georgia and all over the Southeast, even all over the United States, that are going to need a place where they can come not to be beat up, but to be built up, to be spoken life into their heart, to be safe, to be encouraged. And that brings me to what is our unique calling as a church. I believe we're called to be that oasis in the midst of the wilderness. What our island and our coast is to the body, our church should be for the spirit and for the soul. A place of refreshment, a place of tank filling, a place where people can come to learn of God, to know that here you can worship God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and it's going to be found as a cool thing to do. It's going to be acceptable. Our kids went up to Gatlinburg this past week, and it was so awesome to hear my daughter say, you know, to be in a room with 15,000 teenagers worshiping their guts out, and it be the right thing to do and be cool. It was a really awesome experience. I think we should give that to our country. I think we should give that to our region. So here's what I'm going to suggest. If you have that booklet that you received when you came in, take that. Let me show you, point out a couple of things to you. It's this 2020 Vision booklet. As you open it up, I want you to turn to about that third page. On the third page, I want to show you something. While 6,000 to 10,000 churches close their door each year, this year we added 133 new members. We baptized 83 souls into the kingdom of God. Amen? Hey, folks, let's celebrate that. What gets celebrated gets repeated. What gets celebrated gets repeated. 2019, God has blessed this church. You know what? It's been a good year. Did you know that's double what we did in 2018? 2018 was a good year. God doubled it in 2019. What could he do in 2020? Just imagine, he's given us a wind of momentum, of grace, of favor. So what are we going to do with it? I want to suggest on that last page, I want to, in three categories, I want to show you what I think. This is not everything. This is not the sum total. These are the highlights I think we're called to. When I speak of our core essentials as a church, I use three C's: coaching, community, and commission. Coaching is the preaching, teaching, ministry of our church. Community is our organization into groups and classes. And then commission is our world mission impact, where we faithfully obey where Jesus said, go into all the world and make disciples. So two things under each category I want to give you. Number one, under coaching, I believe that what Amelia Island is for the mind and body, our church will be for the spirit. In the coming years, we will seek to provide conferences and workshops for Christians to come and grow and learn and to go back refreshed to make a difference in their community. We have a number of those that we're planning for this year, but the one I want to really emphasize and tell you about is in October the 20th when we have a senior adult conference, where we take the greatest among us from our churches and we build them up and we say, listen, you don't retire from Jesus. We want to send you back to save your churches. We want to send you back to reach the next generation and raise up faithful churches for the glory of God. We're bringing in one of the preeminent speakers with senior adults in all of our nation, Dr. Phil Waldrop. He will be speaking here. It'll just be an ordinary Sunday. But I want you to begin thinking about who you can invite from other churches, other regions, to come here, spend a weekend on Amelia Island, and be built up in their faith and encouraged to go back and make a difference. Secondly, when this church was built, one day we need to have a history day where we just sit down and, for those of you who are new, you learn about the 125-year-old history of this church, about how God has taken us from a single room building to that marvelous downtown property to hear and the miracles that were associated with all of that. It's an amazing story. But when the church came here, there was an intention of building a final part of our building on the north side of our property that would be that mid-range kind of building, mid-range kind of gathering place. You're sitting in the largest single-room venue on the island. That's why concerts are held here during the week and different things. It's a 1,000-plus seat auditorium, and God has given it to us. This is awesome. We have class space, small group space all over this campus. What we don't have a lot of is that mid-range space where 200 or 300 people can gather. Most weddings are under 100 people. When someone has a wedding in here, if you have under 100 people, it can seem kind of sparse in a 1,000-seat auditorium. Funerals can seem that way. And our people, I thank God that our people asked to use this building for their funerals, to say goodbye to their loved ones. This is a very special transition of life. But when we want to do something for 200 or 300 people, we really don't have a good space for it. So this building would serve as that mid-range space, a place for us to do our Wednesday night meals, to have a full commercial kitchen, and to be circled with small group class space, possibly on two floors. And it would be that final, the original vision for this building. We would have that final space gathered together. What I'm suggesting this year is not that we go build it. What I'm suggesting is we just began forming a group, and I'm asking our deacon body to lead in this, to put together a exploratory committee to just start answering the hard questions of what are we talking about with a building? What would it look like? How much would it cost us? Is there an advantage to building it now, or should we pay off our current debt before we start something new? Or is interest rates in our favor now, so we should go ahead and move on it? All of those questions need to be answered. Let's get some specs drawn up. Let's see what it would cost. All of those things need to be answered. So I'm suggesting in this year that we begin answering those difficult questions so that we can be best positioned going into the next 10 years, the roaring 20s, as it were, to make the biggest dent in the kingdom that we could possibly make. So I'm charging them with that, asking them to put that team together. Secondly, community. When it comes to our teaching and our discipleship at our church, there's several things. There are going to be some new classes offered this year, but there are two in particular I want you to focus on. The first, Financial Peace University. Pastor Shad is leading that up. It's going to be taught by video from Dave Ramsey. It's some of the best material in the world on developing a healthy financial life. If you have the time to do it, I would 10 times rather you take that class than being here on Wednesday night. It is a very strong, healthy, worthwhile program, if you're a young family especially. Just starting out, you got little kids. Folks, let me tell you, those jokers are expensive. College, they're for real. And they don't give it to you. I mean, you say, well, mine got a scholarship. Well, you still got to pay for vehicles. You got to pay for living expenses. There's a lot coming at you. You better get it together. And most of you, like me, I didn't have the first financial class in high school. I went to seminary. They didn't talk to me about anything financial. My parents didn't really coach me in that. So we kind of had to learn the hard way. And at the right time, Dave Ramsey's material stepped into our life and really helped get us prepared in that arena. If you're a young family, that's where you need to be. Even if you say, Pastor, I don't have any debt, you still need to be there to fly the plane right. Secondly, Celebrate Recovery. It was the most vital ministry I had at my last church. And we need it twice as bad here as we did there. Listen, the enemy has strategically placed on-ramps onto a destructive highway called substance abuse. We have people in our... I'm tired of it. I'm tired of ministering to families that are devastated by drug abuse, alcohol abuse, you name it, hurts, habits, hang-ups. And Satan has strategically, from the age of like 12 or 13, he starts bringing this stuff, introducing it into lives. And then eventually you have homes that are broken and devastated because of it. I think as a church, we ought to offer a couple of exit ramps along that highway. He's made plenty of on-ramps. We can give a couple of exit ramps. The best I have seen has been Celebrate Recovery. And so I've asked Pastor Shad and some of our lay leadership to begin putting a program together that would fit our church, our needs, and our demographic to begin offering some of those off-ramps on that destructive highway here in our community. Thirdly, commission. Every other year, we host a Global Impact Conference. This year, we're going to host that as well. You see the dates there in September. They're in your bulletin. And we're going to bring in our missionary units from all over the world. My dream has always been when you ask our teenagers or our young adults about missions, it's not a program we throw money at, but it's people that we love, we pray for, we partner with. We're doing trips. We're going to bring people from those trips here, places that we're serving, that we're giving, that we're investing, so that we can see, that we can touch, we can hear face-to-face what God is doing through your faithful prayers and giving week after week all over the world, so that when I say things like the sun never sets on the ministry of First Baptist Church, you know what I'm talking about. Secondly, we have got the most amazing opportunity this year. I want to introduce a couple to you. Daniel and Jesse, if you would come on up. Back a few weeks ago, Julie and I had lunch with Daniel and Jesse Fox, and we were excited to hear about their ministry. They have a ministry to the deaf. Daniel, tell us just a little bit about what your ministry exactly does.
Sure. Check. There we go. Hi, my name is Daniel, and this is my wife, Jesse Fox. Back all the way in 2011, we launched with an organization called Signs of Love, and we work with the deaf around the world. Specifically, we were in Honduras for the past 8 years, and then we've recently transitioned to Chile this past year. And a large part of what we do is ministry to the deaf, specifically deaf that don't have access to language. So most of the deaf around the world are not like the deaf here in the United States that have been blessed with the opportunity to go have an educational system established for them, have an established sign language to where they can go learn their language and be incorporated into a deaf community or even a hearing population as well. Most deaf around the world don't have that opportunity. Most countries in the world don't have those systems. So, for example, in Honduras, we would be going out to rural areas, villages, and really finding deaf that have never had access to language their entire life and teaching them this language. And then through that, we then have the avenue to teach them the gospel. So again, I always kind of say, imagine someone's trying to come up and share Jesus with you, but you have no idea what they're saying and you have no idea how to read anything they're giving you. So you have to give them the language first, and so that's largely what we do.
So through our conversations, I understand that the deaf community is the third largest people group, unreached people group in the world. And the ratio of missionaries to that community is very low. And you're one of the few that have been equipped and called to go into that world. And so you've kind of had that ministry to where you plant these works and get them self-sustaining and move on to a new place, just like the early church. You know, that the way the apostles did in the early church, planting a work, going on to a new work. And so I've heard about this. I've been very excited about it. I've been praying for you guys. We've been supporting you guys as a church for some time, and it's been exciting to me. And so I was hearing about what God was doing in their life, and then I said, well, how are things at your church? They come from an amazing church in Austin, Texas called Austin Stone. It's one of the great churches in our country. And they said, well, it's funny you should ask that, because we feel like God is calling us to move our home church, our base ministry, from Austin to Fernandina Beach and become a part of First Baptist Church. I didn't know what to say. And But then I began to just think on it and realize what an amazing opportunity this is for us as a church. These guys are on the front line of mission. Jesse, tell us a little bit about, you're working on a translation right now. I know when the Bible was translated from the Greek and the Hebrew into the, you know, German or Latin or into English, how that just kind of took ministry to a whole new level and multiplied. And what is it you're working on now?
Yeah, so we left Honduras. We're now in Chile, but the deaf pastor at the church in Honduras where we left, he's illiterate. He can't read or write. And so the only way he has access to preach every Sunday the gospel is through us translating into sign language, so through videos, just scripture. So we started in Genesis about 3 years ago, and we're in 1 Kings, actually, what you preached on today.
Awesome.
We're about there. So yeah, it's a process, but we're excited
See,
to have
she,
the word.
She back. Says it. She says it like, oh, it's just a little thing I'm doing, translating the Bible. And it's like, you know, if you know history, that's staggering. That's staggering. And it's not like there is a sign language that every deaf person speaks. There's different types of sign language for every people group. They have their own words. And some words she's having to come up with. Like, there aren't words for certain things, and she's having to figure those out. How do I do that? I mean, it's an amazing process. And what this will do for the community, the deaf community, is, I mean, if you can see that with the eye of faith, it is unbelievable. And they want you to be their church family to help them to accomplish that end. Are you excited about that, church? Amen. So today, they're joining our church family. They're going to be your part of our tribe, part of our family of faith. And where they go next, we're not sure. But we've make the commitment to them that if they're willing, as the old missionary used to say, if I go down in the pit, I just need you to hold the rope. We're not all called to go, but we can all support, we can all help. And so us having our own missionaries that we're responsible for that are willing to go, that are on the pinnacle, the front line of creativity and just on the cutting edge of mission, it's a very, very exciting opportunity. And folks, that's what it's all about. It's all about making disciples of Jesus, getting the gospel to people who've never heard it before. And we're going to be able to support this precious couple as they go. Now, I know every missionary, there's a few things you got to have. You got to have the call of God, and you got to have some little postcards. So you got some of those little postcards?
Got those out at the Welcome Center. Check us out afterwards and grab a little postcard and hang us on your refrigerator and pray for us. We'd love that.
We're going to pray. We're going to give. We're going to support. We're going to make sure that they have what they need to do the mission they're called to do. In our culture, everything you love, you put on the refrigerator, all right? So I want to see these guys. When I visit your house, I want to see them on your refrigerator, okay? Thank you so much for trusting us to be your support as you go into the mission field. One more time, let's encourage them this morning. So that's the beginning. That's what it looks like to be an oasis for mission, oasis for faithfulness on Amelia Island for the kingdom throughout the world. What's your part? What can you do to make sure that when someone comes to visit us, we make the best impression on them that we can for the glory of God, so that if they come here, you know what I would love to see? I would love for somebody to come to Amelia Island, stay at the Omni, stay at the Ritz, and come to First Baptist, and then tell the bellhop and the porters at the Ritz, y'all really need to go study First Baptist. They know customer service. They know guest services. They know how to love on people. Because I'm telling you, they're the gold standard. The Ritz is the gold standard right now. But I believe that we have the potential to take it up a level. And I think you have the right gift mix to do it. What can you do to make sure that when they put their boys and girls in our nursery, that they can say it's the safest place in Florida, no questions asked, because we've got people who have committed, even though they could be in worship, they could be listening to the sermon, they've committed to serve and to volunteer, to hold boys and girls. Folks, here's the deal. It's about so much more than just having a sermon on Sunday, having a wonderful band and great worship. It's about so much more than that. Unless you do what you do best, what we do is not going to be heard. So working together as a team to create a spiritual oasis in North Florida and South Georgia, and I hadn't figured out which one we are yet. Somebody told me this week, we're the capital of South Georgia. But for our region to be that spiritual oasis, as the world gets drier and drier, a place where God says, go there and you'll find living water. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. With heads bowed and eyes closed, for some of you, the next right thing to do would be to just do what the foxes have done and just say this morning, I want to be a part of that church. They publicly came today in front of all of us to say, I want to unite with your family of faith. Perhaps today you should do the same thing. You know, in our culture, if somebody wants to become an American citizen, they stand publicly. They raise their right hand and they pledge allegiance. When someone wants to commit their life to someone in marriage, they have to do that before witnesses and publicly. And so church membership is no less important. And it, we invite people to come publicly and verbalize to us, we want to join this church. And maybe today it would be the right thing for you to do. Perhaps you need to join today. Maybe you need to come today and just verbalize that you need to be baptized. Maybe you need to come today and give your life to Jesus Christ and say, I want Jesus to be the Lord of my life. But whatever it is God is leading you to do, it takes the obedience of the many to accomplish greatness for the kingdom. And all we ask for you to do is obey. I'm going to pray for you that God will help. Then the ball's in your court. As I pray, you decide what God's leading you to do. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you that I'm in a place of friends. I love these people, and I know they love me. I pray for them, Lord. For some of them, the right next thing for them to do is to join this church. For others, it's to volunteer. Still others, it's to follow through on a commitment that they've made. Father, I ask you to give us all the courage to obey you. Maybe even now, a husband would take a wife by the hand and say, I'm ready if you are. Maybe a young person would bolster his courage and say, as soon as this prayer finishes, I'm taking that first step. And Father, we will all give you the glory. For nothing good happens of the flesh. It's all your work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come if God's drawing.
What's up, everybody? I hope you had a wonderful time worshiping with us today and listening to the word from Pastor Zach. We've got a couple of really exciting things coming up here at First Baptist. Now, next Sunday, February 2nd, we have Mike Williams, who's a Dove Award winner, coming to our church. He's going to be at both services, classic and modern, so make sure you don't miss that.
And I had flown in and taken the overnight, the red eye. Have you taken the red eye? Isn't that a blessing? I was, because of all my frequent flyer miles and my status with Delta, and I probably shouldn't mention the name, okay, with a particular airline, and which is an acrostic for don't expect the luggage to arrive. But anyway, I won't mention the name. Because of my status, I was able to land a wonderful seat in row 34. If you're not familiar with a plane, that's the last row on the plane. Not only did I get row 34, but I got the middle seat in row 34. Yeah, right there. That's a blessing. You know, obviously I was confessing sins and hoping I'd get changed. But no, and look at me. I don't fit in a middle seat. Do you know what I'm saying? Let me just say, if you're on this side and someone's on this side and there's a middle seat open and you see me coming, you're not happy to see me. Okay, let's just be honest. Because you know I'm in that seat and I'm also in your seat. Okay?
Starting Tuesdays at 6 p.m., our choir is kicking off. We're going to be going over future songs for Sunday services, as well as some of the songs for our Easter worship service. It's going to be so great and so much fun. If you're interested at all and you like to sing, feel free to come out Tuesdays at 6 p.m. I hope to see you there. In the first week of July, we are planning a missions trip to Cuba. Now, I am so excited for this amazing opportunity of evangelism. If you're at all interested, we are having a very brief 15 to 20 minute interest meeting in the cafe conference room. Now, that is Y14. We have a small amount of space left for this missions trip, so you have to be 18 or older to be able to go on this. Now, if you're interested at all, please make sure you come over to Y14, the cafe conference room, and we'll give you all the details and information on what we're planning with this missions trip. Thank you guys so much for coming out today, worshiping with us, and just being a part of this amazing community. Guys, as we go forward throughout this week, let's continue to shine the light of Christ in this world. Have a great day.